Hi everybody, it's Green at Singing Bird Farm, Alaska. Yay, my logo. Just wanted to make an appearance. I don't have a cameraman, so most of this will be point of view. Show you more on the farm that's happening. It's certainly not all brown and barren like last time. There's lots going on, and I'm gonna show it to you. Okay, now I'll show you around since everything is watered. Here we planted 75 different strawberry plants, 25 each. They're supposed to be like everbearing. I think it's Ozark and a couple others I don't want you to quote me on. And they have this net over them, as do so many other things at the farm, because I've been so busy chasing away the ravens, and they've been really bad. They pretty much destroyed a line of trees I planted. You don't want a video from that day, I'll show you. So in the background here you can see the potatoes. We planted them down in furrows so they get plenty of water, and then we've got the soil piled up on the side ready to be like kicked in over them to like hill them up. So hopefully they'll like that. It'll be a little cooler down in the furrows than if we had planted them on mounds, but it's gonna save a whole lot of work. This soil was nice and fertile. The front part, I did plant potatoes last year, and the back part is new. Next year, I'll wanna rotate out and do my potatoes somewhere else. And here we have these beautiful raised beds. I showed you these in the last video. And they are at a stage of germination. You can see the little bigger ones are these really cool sunflowers. Lots and lots of carrots in these deep beds. And a lot of chickweed also sprouting along everywhere in the farm, especially you'll see in this dark, this is the humusy trucked in soil in here. And the chickweed has, it wants to take over the world. It's going to be an issue. Paper mulch or something would be best, but I don't see any down. So here we have some kale. I didn't do any brassica root crops this year because I have quite a bit of root maggots built up over a couple years, so I'm cycling those out, but I will be doing some brassica greens. And I have my little peas finally starting to warm up, and things are actually getting a little bit bigger. Come over here, you can see we have some beautiful little lettuces starting right in amongst some carrot sprouts and some chickweed. And over here we have a mix of carrots and some greens and some wildflower seeds, basically a whole bunch of things sprouting that I can barely tell what they are so far, and I'm just kind of letting everything sprout, and I don't want to disturb the little baby seeds by pulling up the weeds next to them, so I'm just gonna let everything get a little bit bigger, and then I'll go through and weed everything at least once this season. Some things will have continuous, but I'll go in at least once, if not twice, and do everything. It'll be interesting to see how this bed does. It's constructed in the same way, but it somehow, you know, the front loader just got a lot more gravel in here. So there are carrots and they are sprouting. It's definitely, it was a little drier at the surface, but the sand in it kind of made up for that by covering the seeds deeper. We'll see how the carrots are affected with the rocks in there. I have a nice line of little cool sunflowers back there too. Here we get to the scene of the crime, the raven crime. The green plants you see down here are artichokes. So these are experimental. Usually they'd be grown in a little warmer climate as a perennial, but if I really get them going, maybe I'll have some small artichokes as an annual. So I have those lined up in two rows, and you can see these little twigs in between. They were trees, and they might come back. So some of them, every like sixth one, there's a row going back right there. And there was another row like right along the stakes up front. Manchurian apricots, and then I had this purple leaf plum hedge and these Nanking cherries that were supposed to be dwarf flowering cherries. They sent me the wrong ones and I put them out anyways, and then the ravens destroyed them, and pretty much the whole tree order is not that good. But I do have a bunch of trees in buckets at home that actually do look good, crab apples, and I was able to save them, but you can see some of the raven damage here. This tree might come back, I'm hoping. I think this is definitely a Manchurian apricot. Here you can see more of what they really did. So this was like a 2 foot tall tree, it was still a twig, it wasn't very happy, but it was dormant and it was going to come back to life, and they just went down the line and snapped them off. And so there's like sticks along the side. There's another one that just got brutalized, and then next to that, just a hole. I wasn't able to find the tree. Here's another one, couple sticks on the ground, nothing with roots anymore. I don't even think they wanted it for nesting material. It's just gone. I think they just did it because this is their open spot and they like it, they're territorial. And I put a bunch of things that stick up. And so they got mad one day, they left him for about a week, and they just went down the line and took him down. They probably weren't mad. They were probably having a great time as they did it, but I was mad. So maybe some will come back. I just put these stakes up, or we had some, and I just wove the fishing line, as you can see, around everywhere I could reach and get to. And I actually think it's been somewhat effective. I did this everywhere I could before we put the netting up on the other ones. And I could see places where they maybe got tangled, like it was loosened. But overall, the fishing line has worked. Although after I put this up, they went over for these asparagus crowns with the pinwheels, and they were pulling them up over there on the other side. You can see the row of pinwheels. And they just would not stop pulling them up every day, even though they didn't want them right next to the pinwheels, because I ran out of line. So, but now they gave that up. Yeah. So anyways, now Ralph's back helping me put up nets, chase away the ravens, and they're still squawking around today, but they're not actually like dive bombing me, and there weren't seven lined up, and we might be making headway on the raven scene, and they don't actually want my plants, they just want the territory. So this is more fun. This is some flaxseed that I planted. You can see I planted it to grow very, very thickly, and it's doing great. I've got about a 8 by 14 foot patch, and I watched this cool YouTube video, and this guy just grew a 10 by 10 patch in his lawn and made some flax out of it, or some linen, or I mean at least the flax that you could spin by hand and potentially make into linen. So I'm gonna give it a shot. I've been really pleased with how fertile this soil is, even though it looks all rocky and red. Actually really grew some great plants last year, better in comparison to the other stuff. So I planted, how much you can see the furrows, they're kind of shallow. There's some greens seeds in here, some lettuces and some kale, and a few little baby lettuces I transplanted. And along the edge of this furrow with the potatoes, there's some onion sets, so I'll give that a chance. So here's the asparagus trench that I put the crowns. They were the raven's favorite for a minute, with the pinwheels, and they dug them up right underneath the pinwheels like they really don't care. Here's one that didn't get buried all the way, you can see. Still wants to grow. So yeah, pinwheels don't work. But I tell you what does work is asparagus. And I planted some last year in this in desperate need of weeding trench here. See if I can get them. There's one. So that's a 1 year old, so I planted them last spring. I have another tray of seedlings to put out too. This is Jersey Night, Can't really eat them when they're so small. They need to save their energy, but I did nibble on one and it was really delicious. Here's some more coming up right in front there and in back too, actually. So now that I can tell who's who in this patch, definitely time to weed them out. And then back here, we have the pea tent. The fishnet's gonna be our trellis and maybe bunny protector, I don't know. And there's like a lot of pea seeds planted along the inner edge in there. We have our basic compost pile. And this is the seed bed that you could see me watering. And this is also has fishing line strung around it. Everything planted in trenches for the water again. And a lot of greens. So hopefully this will do well too. So definitely planted a lot of carrots. This whole bed is planted up with carrots. And I'm going to do some soil sampling today. I'll take a sample from this, which is the soil that was trucked in. And also, I can do this without making you too dizzy, from the native subsoil over there that I have the stuff planted in, which is not the topsoil. They piled the topsoil up in that pile, scraped it off. And so there was like an old fire, and it's just this old sandy, rocky soil that's surprisingly even more fertile than the dark stuff. You can even see the two colors between the raised bed has the peaty, humusy stuff, and then the actual ground is so much lighter colored. So it clearly has less organic matter, but it has all the biochar, and the ashes seem to have neutralized over the years, and it's just really good. So I'm gonna take a look at it, see if I can figure out why. Now here's an experiment that actually worked. We tried to overwinter a lot of stuff, beets and cabbage, and we made structures and plastic, and we put glass down and all kinds of things, and none of that worked at all. Either like the rabbits and the voles got in and ate the cabbage, or the beets just definitely didn't make it. But here we have one place that actually did work. This is, I believe, the bunching onion. And I put these in, and all we did, we didn't cover them with anything artificial. We just put a lot of leaf mulch on top, and here they are. They're coming up in their second year. I think if this is the type of onion that I'm pretty sure it is, it's a perennial bunching onion, and I'll be able to separate out some and leave some in the ground, and it'll just continue to come up. So since this is a great thing, I have a couple more trays of this started this year, and I've really been working to just get on a cycle with onions, trying different varieties. Most of the time it takes 2 years from seed, and if I could get the right timing and we could utilize this good soil, could get some good onions. One more thing I'll show you here is a rhubarb. It's like just in the shade here. I've got about a dozen plants in a row back here. These are from seed. I planted these, I guess it was 2 years ago now, two springs ago, and I have another 300 rhubarb plants, babies, that I'm going to put in the ground this year over back there in those rows where the greens are growing now. And then I will have a small yet fairly large area of rhubarb, which sounds like a great thing to me. It just grows all giant, it's hungry, wants a lot of food, likes water, but you don't, it just overwinters, and every year it gets bigger. Same with the asparagus, you know, 20 years in the ground, it's a perennial, it just comes up in the spring before anything you could possibly transplant would be able to survive. That's what I really want, amongst so many other things. I don't know if you can see the color of this, you can really see the difference. This one's a beautiful red one. And then right next to it here growing, these are much greener. So since I did start them from seed, there'll be considerable variation, but I can divide the ones that I want and they'll all be good.
So I hope you like my virtual farm tour. There is another one on my channel from earlier this year when none of this was really happening yet. And I'll do another one when things are actually growing and I've done some of this work I pointed out to you.